Well, here we back. Tim Elenz, Jeff Ford, and Alan Orlowsky. Alan of Orlowsky and Wilson. Hey, where can people get a hold of you if they want to?
They can call me at my office.
What's your office number?
847-325-5559.
Why would somebody call you? Because they have tax questions?
Because they have tax questions, or they need an estate plan, okay. Or corporate legal matter.
Can I call about statistics of the Department of Labor if I
no.
just want to?
Sorry.
Okay, folks.
That won't work.
We're back. 847-931-1410 for those who want to call. We're back to the tax cuts. And you were talking about, I watched Chris Wallace. It was very, very good.
And he was saying that the extended, the compromise that Obama made was basically would be in quote-unquote the second stimulus package to work its magic on the economy, to help the economy, I should say. Is that something? And then people were kind of like backing off on the panel saying, no, it's not really a stimulus package. So do you think it's a stimulus package with the extended tax cuts? Or, I mean, it's the same tax cuts as it was last year.
Well, it'll stimulate the economy. You can call it
you
an
hope.
Apple or an egg
yeah.
or an
right.
orange, but it is going to stimulate the economy.
Because people go out and spend money, and it gets taxed, and it circulates like
right.
Blood, basically. So it
right.
just kind of goes around, and the state, the county gets taxes,
right.
and it goes into a different. So it ends up back at the government.
Yeah,
well,
then they
some
get their
form.
Share of the tax.
In
yeah.
theory, then, would lowering the taxes even more, or cutting the taxes even more, be a better stimulus, would stimulate the economy even more?
There are those who argue that, Dave.
Yes.
You know.
Quite
I mean,
possibly.
Yeah.
But what's the right number? That's what they're always arguing about. What's the right number?
Well, we've got these two heads. We've got we'll stimulate the economy, and let's also balance the budget, which this is not helping, I guess.
Well,
it's not.
I'm sorry. Remember Brady talking about getting rid of the gasoline tax mm-hmm. when Bill Brady was running for governor? He said mm-hmm. if we get rid of the state of Illinois gas tax, we will increase people buying gas here instead of crossing
state
over
line.
To Indiana.
Yeah.
I don't ever recall going across the county line, and I live on Kankakee County border.
Well, if you live right on the line, you might,
Possibly.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't even know that I even look at the signs anymore to see who's less money, because I always assume.
There was a great difference with gas taxes. If you go over to, like we're talking about where it's 305 in Cook County, it would be what's north of us? Is that DuPage or is that
McHenry?
DuPage.
McHenry or whatever.
Lake
I mean,
County.
McHenry, it's like 10 or 12 cents cheaper.
Yeah.
Oh, maybe I'll start getting my gas in McHenry County.
Yeah, I don't know if that's going to make a big difference. I thought, cutting the gas tax, that's kind of a lame idea. What they really need to do is just cut government, cut the number of people in government and make it leaner and meaner.
Does that hurt the economy then? If you get rid of people, you take people off the payroll in the government?
I think in the short run it would, but in the long run it would make the economy more productive.
So we would have to lower, instead of a 33, I don't even know what our, was 34% top tax rate right now?
36.
It is 36? Okay, so if you lowered, you got rid of the overhead, the waste in government, would you lower the income tax rate? And then theoretically?
Yes.
These are theoretically.
Theoretically you could,
yeah.
because you'd save money. You'd have more money to let, you need, the government would
yeah.
need less money.
Yeah, I think, and one thing that Paul and I wish Paul was still here, but Paul and I agree upon is that, if you want to raise taxes, but spend my money efficiently.
Right.
And nobody's spending the money efficiently right now.
I agree, and one of my pet peeves, Tim, is defense, $800 billion, more than all the other first world countries combined. Cut defense by 25%, you can pay for national health care, you can keep your tax cuts, you can start balancing the budget. We spend an inordinate amount of money on weapons.
Right. And I think Secretary Gates is attempting to do that right now, make the military leaner and meaner, because there's a lot of bureaucratic levels that are unnecessary.
but there's a lot of companies that, the companies that make the airport scanners, the Sun-Times, our parent newspaper, those companies lobby Congress like crazy. And one of them is a defense contractor. So all of a sudden the military, their stance on don't ask, don't tell. Mr. Gates' stance on cutting the military, making it leaner and meaner. When the military starts making more sense than the politicians, that's really a scary thought.
Maybe it's a good thought.
It is.
Yeah. But that's part of their job, is to make themselves lean and mean. And at the same time,
hasn't been in the past.
Make it smaller and more lethal. Mm-hmm. And that's what they need to do. But, you know, we've got two wars going on. I don't know how they're going to do that.
Yeah, I never understood why we are still wrapped up in these wars after 9 years. We have the greatest military. We have push-button Atari-type attack systems, and we're still there.
Because we didn't learn from Vietnam.
Well, I think the reason we're not being in Iraq, maybe that war quite possibly could have been a mistake. Probably was. But Afghanistan, I guess the reasoning is that we're preventing the Taliban from finding a nuclear weapon somewhere and blowing it up in Rome or Paris or New York City. That would be the end game to me. Because otherwise, you know, what threat do they pose?
The Taliban?
Yeah.
Well, I don't think it's the human rights issue that we all are being told that's going on over there, because there's dozens of countries that have human rights issues.
Right.
And we're not over there invading China or invading Iran or invading...
Ironically,
Syria. I think Syria and Egypt are our allies, if I believe. And
well, Egypt certainly is. But ironically, the place that the Taliban would be likely to get a nuclear weapon is Pakistan, and that's one of our allies. But
right.
Alan, I didn't mean to take you this far afield.
Well, that's okay.
Go ahead. Yeah,
take me a far afield. I like that.
Okay.
We're still talking about that statistic with the middle class and the millionaires.
Well, you know, Alan had we talked off the air a little bit, and I couldn't remember the statistic exactly, but Alan, you said, you know, the years ago, I don't know how many years ago.
Like in the 60s.
In the 60s, the average, or 70s maybe even, the average CEO made, what, 17 times more than the lowest paid worker in the company?
Yeah, let's say 20.
And now what is it?
200.
Yeah. To kind of offset Tom's argument.
Some incredible number.
And what do you think drives that? Do you think it drives publicly traded companies, want the shareholders want to wham, bam, get in? Get out with big profits, and they pay CEOs to manipulate the...
And the old boy network, you know? I mean, it's getting harder and harder to crack that ceiling.
That's probably part of it. Part of it is probably the fact that they instituted options. Employees could get stock options from their company, and the CEO's got a whole bunch of options, and that, I believe, their option income is also part of their... is considered as part of their compensation. So they were trying to, these CEOs would get a lot of options, drive the price of the stock up. And that's what, before the crash and... The recent crash in 2009,
2008, yeah.
That's what the CEO of Lehman Brothers was trying to do. Crank that, you know, get the stock up, leverage derivatives, so on and so forth, so he would make more money.
Was it kind of what Enron did, too?
That's exactly what I was thinking, too.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
I have a question for Alan. Can you explain to me the controversy of what's going on with the estate tax, or whatever they call the death tax? What is the controversy? How does this affect us?
Well, most people don't like death taxes. They think it's unfair.
Why?
Because it's money that's already been taxed to get it. That's not necessarily true. Some of it is not taxed, but that's the mantra I hear about people who really hate the death tax.
You know what? Can I? I'll just interrupt one second, and Dave,
you
actually
it's your
you
show.
Want.
What? Go on.
But how is it not taxed? So if Dave's worth $10 million, and I'm his son,
I'll give you an example. You inherit a building that's worth $10,000 when your father dies.
That would be
40
me.
Years later, it's worth $1 million.
Okay.
Okay. Has it been taxed?
Well, but when I sell it, then it's going to be taxed.
If you sell it, there'll be a capital gains tax.
Okay.
Yes. However, if you die with it, it gets a step up in basis. You give it to your kids, and there's no tax paid.
Oh, okay.
So that's not altogether true. But in any case, it's the tax is disliked, whether the reasons are rational or not. But Obama wanted the estate tax exclusion to go down to $1 million. It looks like under the law that's being the new law that the compromise bill that is going to be somewhere between the exclusion is going to be somewhere between $3.5 and $5 million per estate, which is a fair exclusion. If the exclusion went down to $1 million, was it $1 million? I think roughly 2% of the estates in the country are taxed. And at $3.5 million, about one-third of 1% of estates are taxed. That's it. One out of every 300 estates. $5 million, it's probably a little less, too. So it really doesn't impact very many people.
But I like when they give it a name like the death tax. It used to be the estate tax. When they wanted, when the Republicans wanted it to go through, they'll call something the Patriot Act they like or the death tax they don't like.
Or death panels.
Yeah.
Sarah Palin's death panels.
Yeah. Hey, what were you going to ask? I'm sorry. Do you
remember? No, what was it? I mean, do you agree? You said it's not going to affect as many people. I mean, the estate tax. Because the Republicans want to abolish the estate tax and the Democrats want to keep the estate tax?
I would say, yeah, that's the basic difference in philosophy.
The
estate tax doesn't even generate that much money for the government. It's something like, I don't know, $25 billion, $40 billion a year. Maybe at the max, $40 billion a year.
And yet it was one of the things brought up in this the compromise with President Obama and the Republicans. Senate Republicans.
You know, but I think originally it was created to prevent an elite class from owning all the wealth in the country. Like you had the aristocracy in Europe. The landed gentry. But, you know...
But there's loopholes, right? I mean, if I die and I give my great son... You've been a wonderful
I'm
son,
a great,
Tim.
Thank you.
Tim,
and thank
I
you,
give...
The resemblance is uncanny.
So why don't you call me?
Sorry to hear that.
So I leave him my estate, which is... which is like a $1 million estate or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be...
That's all you're leaving me?
That's all I'm leaving you. Well, I got a couple mistresses in Haiti, so... So...
Haiti?
No, I heard it was Bimini, but case.
Bimini, same thing.
Oh, man. Yeah, just like the cricket.
Okay, but go ahead. So what
so
you
if
saying?
If my estate is $1 million and I leave that to Tim.
Your son, yeah.
To his son.
Yeah.
Your son always wanted Tim. He's going to be paying taxes, what, in the future or as I get after
well,
my there, death?
Well, at $1 million, there's no tax. You just give it to him.
Okay. And that's right now?
Right now.
Okay.
A week, Saturday, it might be $3.5 million or $5 million.
Okay.
Okay, but going back, let me, if you're done, is that your
I'm done.
Question? Okay. Let's go back to that building thing that you were talking about, okay? But can't they put something more detailed in there? Like if I have a $10 million cash and I want to leave it to you as my son, I should be able to do it. But if it's an appreciating asset,
yeah,
there shouldn't. Couldn't there be like rules governing those types of assets instead of just doing a blanket across the board?
Well, without getting too complicated,
please don't.
What happens is that if you die with an asset under the estate tax, you get what's called a step up in basis, so you avoid the capital gain.
Okay.
So if they eliminated the estate tax, you wouldn't get that. You'd just get the building, but then if you sold it.
Right.
The basis would be 10,000, not a million, and you'd have a capital gain of 990,000.
Yeah. The other problem, too, Al, isn't it that, I mean, and we've seen this lately, that assets can depreciate?
Yes, cash depreciation.
Cash is depreciating.
Yeah.
We have a caller on our line.
Yes, we do. We have Rob on the phone. Rob.
Hi, Rob. Are you there?
How are you guys doing tonight?
Good. How are you, Rob?
Yeah,
good.
Doing great. Hey, I just had a thought. You know, one of the things in the package that they're wrestling over right now is an extension of unemployment benefits. And I wondered if anybody had ever brought up the idea of every time you extend unemployment benefits to maybe decrease that amount, that monthly amount, by 5% or 10%, whatever is a reasonable number, and thereby effectively wean people off of it so it doesn't become a forever thing. You know, it was designed to work for 6 months to get you through, and now these are harder times, but there should be an end to it at some point.
Go ahead.
I agree. Although I think we have to be careful here because we're facing the kind of recession none of us have seen most of us haven't seen in our lifetime. And unemployment isn't that much to begin with. I haven't been on it, but I've heard some people, and you can't really – it's not like welfare. It's not the kind of thing that I think you would want to try to survive a life on when you're used to working.
I think what a lot of people do is, okay, they catch unemployment, they get a few more benefits, you know, along the side, and then everybody goes and works on the side, you know.
Some people do.
There are contractors that do that.
No doubt about it.
You know, and you know, I'm not talking some draconian number to slice it in half, but whether you pruned 5% off of it or 10% off, whatever is the sensible number, and each time it gets extended, there's a little bit less of it. So at some point, people have to buck up and take less of a job than maybe that they would have liked in the first place.
Well, I think that I would agree with you. You know, it's just you know, everybody's got an opinion about that, but it certainly wouldn't hurt. I think it's a good idea.
Rob, I would agree with you if the times were a bit better. Yeah, I think this is an
well,
extraordinary
well, yeah,
situation.
You know, and I like what Rob says, and I'm trying to recall. I've never collected unemployment, but I remember when Ronald Reagan was president, and I worked for the Chicago Park District for a while, and I had gotten laid off, and I remember hearing that unemployment was 26 weeks, and one of the things that the federal government did is there was a 20-week extension, and the federal government took away that 20-week extension. And I remember, oh, my gosh, how could you do that?
Mm-hmm.
Now, maybe I'm Rip Van Winkle and I fell asleep or something, but now it's 99 weeks
for unemployment? Yeah, it
seems to be
2 years.
It is, but you still are supposed to pay into your own unemployment. And if the jobs were out there...
Wait a minute, nobody pays an unemployment.
You and I do.
Yeah, I do as an employer.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Not as an employee.
but we're...
Yeah, and I'm at 8%. Yeah. Yeah, I'm at the highest in
right.
rate. Because we fire people, so no.
It's like a benefit. You know, employees
yeah,
do
right.
pay for it indirectly.
Right, but I think that people really want to work right now. I've never seen, Rob, you're right about especially some contractors taking money on the side, but people really want to get back to work, and that's the message I think they sent in the November elections.
Yeah, and the other, you know, it's a matter of opinion. How much do you want our country to be a nanny state? How long do you take care of people? You know, I think one of the statistics is that...
You know,
go ahead.
I'm not talking a draconian change here to chop it down at 20 bucks a month or something, but slowly at least reduce the amount of that benefit. You know, the insurance portion of unemployment that everybody essentially has earned is only going to carry you through that first, 25 weeks or whatever. After that, it becomes pretty much strictly a add-on federal benefit that's being paid for by printing up more money.
Well, let's get through these times,
I
Robin.
Just thought maybe that's something that should be considered.
Yeah, well,
there's
some statistic out there that most people who are on unemployment get their job like in the last 2 months before their unemployment expires. So you can extrapolate from that maybe there's a lot of people who just take their unemployment and don't look for a job until those 2 months. I don't know.
Okay. Well, thank you, Rob.
All right. Hey, I'll hang up, but thanks much. Great show, guys.
Thanks for calling in, Rob.
Thank you.
I hope you call in again.
Thank you.
All right,
thank you.
Take care. Bye.
And Al, I do have issues with, like you, with the nanny state, but what bothers me is Wall Street and their bets on mortgages was primarily responsible for our latest economic wonder time, and not one of them has done a perp walk. You know,
mm-hmm.
then you need to extend unemployment benefits if you're going to let these guys off the hook. And they're back to record bonuses and
right.
record earnings.
Right.
You know,
but that doesn't make one by making two wrongs don't make a right, though. You know, that's.
But they should these guys should have been held accountable for what they did. Telling their clients to buy these things and then dumping them themselves. They just ran out of the bottom,
Yeah.
As Matt Taibbi said in Rolling Stone, they ran out of idiots to keep buying it.
Right. Well, obviously there was some wrongdoing, quite a bit of wrongdoing on Wall Street. I think there's an investigation actually going on right now.
Well, Goldman Sachs has already settled. None of those guys are ever going to jail.
I think they're investigating a few hedge fund guys right
they
now.
They are, but it's going to be symbolic at best. You know, the first thing Obama should have done is made some of those guys, held some of them accountable. And I think that
a lot of them play within the rules? I mean, some of the things you're talking about
is
fraud.
It is fraud to tell your customers to buy something you're dumping.
Yeah, they did. Goldman Sachs evidently did.
So what are going forward? What do you think going forward the country needs to do? We know what the problem is.
As far as unemployment or...
Unemployment, taxes, stimulating the economy.
You're our expert, Al. Save us.
God, there's so many problems.
He didn't know he was walking into this one.
Wait,
we get another hour on this?
He's bringing out his big, giant book.
No opinions.
Well, I long-term, everybody tends to look at this short-term like, Obama's been in office 2 years. Everything's supposed to be rosy now. No way. This is a huge credit crisis. It takes years to get out of a credit crisis. I think we need to grow the economy. we need to inflate the economy. We need some inflation because that is how you get out of credit crises.
Oh,
you inflate out of it so that your debt becomes worth a little less.
Mm-hmm.
And lower taxes for the time being. And then we have to work the longer term toward working toward balancing the budget. I think you know, when Clinton was in office, he balanced the budget. You know, the economy was humming.
A Democrat.
Yeah, believe it or not. He had a lot of help
Republican from Congress.
You've got to give Newt Gingrich a lot of credit for that.
Thank you.
And then we have to work on the debt. We got to work on, you know, paying down or not increasing the $14 trillion debt we have.
I'm sitting in Paul's chair, you know, so I'm kind of trying to defend the right
it's
here.
It's rubbing off on you?
Yeah, I'm trying to defend the right here. And
what do you think about that? I mean, what would you do?
I think there's a lot of things. I think we could do a four-hour show on this easily.
Right.
A lot of things. Manufacturing jobs are gone. There's jobs that are gone that are never coming back.
Right.
There's internet jobs that started up, put into the infrastructure of the internet and the dot-coms. Those are gone. You know,
we're going to have this fight going forward forever because when they're paying somebody $10 a day in India, we can't compete with that.
Yeah, and almost every number, every 800 customer service number, it's another country, the Philippines,
right.
It's India and everything. So we're seeing jobs that'll never, ever be replaced.
Right.
You and I have a mutual client, I mean, and you know who I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. That's a dying industry. And, mm-hmm. and Mr. D, God bless him, I think he's a genius. But he, you know, he talks about, I have to take care of these people because these people are from Europe. These are Eastern Europeans.
Right.
Can't find any Americans that are going to do the craftsman work that these people do.
Right.
And so that's been going since the breakup of. Do we have a call?
We have a caller from Amber. Amber has a comment regarding our conversation.
Hi, Amber. How are you?
Hi, guys. I'm doing good. How are you?
Hi,
Thank
Amber.
You for calling. I'm sorry. Thank you for calling.
No problem. I just wanted to make a comment about the unemployment. My husband personally has been unemployed since March. He lost his job, and he's been looking for a job ever since. It's just. The United States currently just doesn't have any jobs out there. I mean, we used to a long time ago, you know, produce products in the U.S. Now everything is being produced in China, which gives less job opportunities to us. So it's not something that, you know, my husband's not trying to find or any unemployment person is trying to find a job. It's just there's nothing out there.
Can I ask you what he does?
He's a mechanic.
Okay. What kind of mechanic?
He's a mechanic. Yeah.
Auto mechanic?
He's a mechanic. Auto mechanic, yep.
Okay.
And it's just hard for him to find any jobs out there because, you know, everybody's either tenured or been together. So now he's at the point where he has to look at a different position or even warehouse positions. Mm-hmm. And those are not even out there barely. And I think it's harder now for men to actually find a job because most men is not in the corporate realm.
How old is how old is your husband?
33.
Well, he's still pretty young. Well, you know, actually, a mechanic-type job, that kind of job, is a job that's going to remain in the United States because you can't ship a car to India to have it repaired. You got to have it repaired here.
Right.
So,
that's true. But
I think, Amber, you know, as a columnist, I hear people talk to me, people email me, and what you're saying is, my husband's looking for work. He's not sitting back taking unemployment. And that's kind of what I was saying. I think people really want jobs.
Right. Yeah.
I would agree with that.
I mean, he's bored. He doesn't want to stay home. He's not used to that.
Well, this is why we need to get the economy in general going so that there are more jobs. People are driving more, buying cars, getting their cars fixed. And because a lot of this, I'm sure a lot of repair work in automobiles has been deferred.
Right. Yeah. Just wanted to leave that comment out there that, you know, not everyone's just been there.
well, we know that. We're aware of that.
Thanks for calling, Amber.
Best
appreciate
of luck to your husband.
Good
Amber.
Luck.
We really hope
good
gets
luck.
A job.
It'll turn around.
Oh, thank you.
But thank you.
Thanks for calling.
I had lunch with my friend Fred. If Fred's listening, hello, Fred, yesterday. And Fred's an ex-naval officer, and we were talking about the military, when you go in the military and how you get paid. And I see, you know, the most important thing about the military is the job training. When you get out, you know, the education. I think the military is phenomenal. I think everybody should be required to go into the military.
Should we have a discussion about that?
We got 2 minutes if you want to. But I was just talking about how it teaches you to fish
right.
rather than
right.
feeding you fish. And I think a lot, I'm going to get in trouble with the unions, as I always do. I think the unions basically give you fish, and they give you more fish, but you got to keep coming back.
Utterly agree.
And the structure of the military is it teaches you to fish. Yeah. And then when you don't fish in this hole, they bring you to another hole, and they give you different job training. And I don't hear anybody talking about job training. And that's what I remember when I was in my 20s and I was looking for a job. Job training, retraining. Oh, you know what that is?
No, what is it?
That is a song that means that we are wrapping up.
Oh.
So,
well,
Tim, thanks for having me.
Yeah, thank you, Jeff and Alan.
And thank you for having me.
And thank you for coming on. And
subscribe to the Beacon
Alan,
Courier News.
Yes, Al, where can we get a hold of you if we need to get a hold of you?
847-325-5559.
Thank you.
Feel free to call.
You get a hold of Jeff here because he always comes and hangs out and buys us coffee and has lunch with us.
I appreciate you,
thank you
letting that restraining order lapse every now and then, Tim.
Thanks, everybody. And Paul Edwards will be back with us next week.